Hello everyone, I'm Ernie Humphrey, the CEO of Treasury Webinars. I would like to thank everyone for taking the time to join our webinar today, AR Automation, Winning Approval, Maximizing Your ROI. I would like to thank our webinar partner today, Esker, whose strong commitment to thought leadership in the finance, treasury, and AR professions help us make this webinar possible today. Companies that invest in AR done right impact the P2P efficiency of their customers while lowering their DSO, bad debt write-offs, and improving working capital management. How do you construct a winning business case for investing in AR automation and maximize the ROI your company realizes for this investment? Today, you will discover 10 tips for making and communicating a winning business case for AR automation. You will also learn how to measure, report, and manage AR-related KPIs that matter to quantify and communicate the value of AR automation and AR done right at your company. Before we delve into the content, I'm going to offer a few quick words about Treasury Webinars, cover a few housekeeping items, cover our learning objectives as they offer the pillars of our value proposition to you for investing an hour of your valuable time with us, and then we'll take a quick walk through our agenda. At Treasury Webinars, we offer virtual events to empower Treasury, AP, and AR receivable success at companies of all sizes across all industries. We only do what we do best, virtual events. Now for the exciting housekeeping items. For any of you interested in receiving CTP credits for today's webinar, you'll have to answer all of our polling questions, remain online for the duration of the webinar, and complete the post-webinar survey, which will launch immediately at the conclusion of the webinar today. If you have any questions regarding CTP credit or would like a copy of today's presentation, please send an email to ernie@treasurywebinars.com. Again, that's ernie@treasurywebinars.com. I'd like to hear from you today, and I'd take your questions at any time in the questions area of your GoToWebinar control panel. I'll do my best to get to your questions if we have time for a Q&A session at the tail end of the webinar. Fear not. If I do not get to your questions, I will follow up with you directly after the webinar. Finally, I appreciate everyone's consideration in taking a short survey at the end of the webinar today, as we always strive to improve the ROI we offer our event attendees for your valuable time. Now, our learning objectives. What's my value proposition for you today? I'd like you to be able to identify specific opportunities to leverage AR automation to mitigate AR processing costs at your company, identify specific opportunities to improve customer relationships and productivity across the enterprise by leveraging AR automation, and to identify specific opportunities to increase cash flow and to reduce bad debt write-offs and DSO at your company. So how are we going to accomplish our objectives today? Well, first, we're going to take a little bit of a higher view. We're going to talk about how to assess your AR operation. So before you really make the decision if AR automation is right for you, we need to take that good look in the mirror. So we need to really look at where we're at, right, in terms of AR operation, benchmark where you might be at regarding some trends and best practices for other companies that are further along the journey to best-in-class AR operations at their company, right? And then once we get there, you'll see it's pretty amazing. The business case will make itself. So we'll specifically walk you through building a winning business case for AR automation. So first, we'll start things in theory with that overview. So I've got 10 tips I'm going to share with you. So 10 specific tips, and then we're going to really show you how it's done and really take a deep dive into it. And then we'll bring things home right for your business case and really how to make that happen, right? That winning business case. And again, how to communicate with impact. 10 ways AR done right impacts the bottom line. Any CFO is going to respond if you can outline in a business case 10 impacts of the bottom line. And the great thing is it's not only impacting your cost, it's also impacting your top line. It's removing your productivity growth. It's fueling growth. If you look at CFO surveys, one of the top things that you'll see across the board is companies know that they need to deepen their relationships with customers, right? Drive organic growth, deepen our relationships. And in today's subscription economy, you have to earn that business, right, all the time, not just once every couple of years. And so it's tremendously important. And then we'll wrap things up with a few closing thoughts, and I'll share a little bit about, we have an upcoming event, the Treasury Evolution Virtual Forum, I'd like to let everyone know about. So let's go ahead, before we get started, level set a little bit on where we're at in our audience so I can focus my content a little bit more effectively. So just asking you to share with me where you're at in terms of automating accounts receivable. Maybe you're just starting the discovery phase, you're evaluating, you have a short list, or you're implementing or already have an AR automation solution in place, or you don't know, don't worry. I'm not going to tell on you. So please be honest in your answers to our survey questions today. Just a quick reminder, again, those of you interested in receiving CTP credits for today's webinar, you will need to answer all of our polling questions here today. Of course, I appreciate everyone's consideration in answering all of our polling questions here today. So let me go ahead, in order to be mindful of our time, I'm going to go ahead and leave the polling question up for another 5 seconds or so, and then we'll go ahead and take a quick peek at the results, and then we'll start to dive in to how to assess your AR operations and really start to see where there's areas of improvement. Again, we have to take that good look in the mirror. And those of you who might not be directly involved in AR, maybe you're in treasury, it's really going to be outstanding opportunity for you to have that conversation with your AR colleagues. I always say in treasury, we need to take more control of that cash conversion cycle. And so this is some great opportunities to give you some great questions and conversations to start. So let's go ahead and close the polling question. Let's go ahead and take a quick look at the results. And so this thing that is eye-popping to me, which you know I'm going to say, 38% of you don't know. And so your homework, right, is to go have those conversations with your AR leading. Maybe it's your credit manager, your director of credit. And so if that doesn't fall right up through treasury, that's a conversation that you definitely want to have. So again, what I often see When I see CFO priorities and treasury leader priorities, I also hear about digital transformation, all these buzzwords, but blocking and tackling done right, there's tremendous opportunities for value and there's so much low hanging fruit. So especially if you're in treasury, let's look at how we can work with AP and AR to control that cash conversion cycle. Today we'll focus on the accounts receivable side of the house. So thank you so much everyone for sharing your insights with us. And so really, like I said, let's just go ahead and talk about how to assess your AR operations. And so one of the things that I like to do is just say, sometimes we just have to look at, right, what is accounts receivable done wrong? And sometimes this is just a conversation, right, with your AR team, your leaders, maybe your credit manager, ask them how things are going, what are their challenges. And so what we see when AR gone wrong, and these are kind of some of the warning signs, I would say, that AR automation is right for your company. I strongly believe that AR automation is a good fit for any company of any size, and especially those companies that are growing. So it's something that the value you may grow into a little bit. But as you start to grow your business, especially across borders and across industries, AR can become extremely more complicated. So we want to make sure that AR is not inhibiting our company growth in that way. So what happens? AR gone wrong. We have high operational costs, so there's many components to that. Those of you on the treasury side, what will speak to you guys is the cash application side. How much does it cost us to apply that cash on just the processing costs? How much time are folks spending chasing our payments? What's our DSO? Again, how much time are we spending on the phone chasing money? Why are we spending money? And then related to that is low productivity. So when we start to look at the metrics of our analysts, what are they spending their time on? Are we getting more money in? Are we getting it in on our terms? Are we getting it electronically? And then we see increase gone wrong. We see sales DSO, right? So let's look at DSO versus our terms. And so let's take a look at that. What are our terms? If they're net 30, right? Where are we at? And then if we're offering dynamic discounting, are we taking, you know, are we doing some discounts? We should look at that as well. And then again, another things to look at, again, you want to take that look in the mirror from A to Z, right? So how long does it take to process, right, that receipt? What about deduction resolutions? Are people taking deductions they're not eligible for? How long does that take? Look at how much control you have over post-sale collections interactions. And so one of the things that I think is really amazing about some of the leading technologies now is it gives us visibility into all the communications between our AR team and our customers. And so I think this has always been a sore point with sales, and I think we need to collaborate with sales. We need to look at how we're communicating with our customers, right? What's the tone and tenor? How are we doing that? Emails, phone calls. And so we're all on the same page. And then some of the other ways AR gone wrong, so you don't have visibility for data tracking or reporting. And so what the worst case is we can tell our sales guys we need to call the customer. We don't have the money in. Well, guess what? The money's in and the cash hasn't been applied and we're holding an order, right? I worked in manufacturing, that happens. And so that's some areas where we can see areas for opportunity. And then we have decreased customer satisfaction rates. So let's look at, and when we're measuring customer satisfaction, we should also include their interactions with our AR team. So one of the things that we should do when we're working with our AR team, every interaction that we have with a customer should have a desired outcome. So was the outcome met? Was it not met? What happened? Why didn't it happen? And there are also some artificial intelligence is coming into this area as well to tell us how to interact as well. So again, just important to really see that, okay, low hanging fruit, just maybe you're not directly involved in AR, but have these conversations. Hopefully a lot of you are shaking your heads, whether it's directly or you hear about these things. One of the couple things, again, just to put a fine point on it, is if you find out how much time folks are spending on the phone, right, with these deductions, chasing money, or their trends, right, or what's causing their resolution time. Again, you want to find out how much it costs us, cost to process a receipt. That's something that I strongly encourage you to go through. And then what you'll see as you build up that cost is you'll start to see how many people are involved in the process, how many systems are involved in the process, how much manual intervention is involved in the process, where the bottlenecks are, and you really start to see all these areas of opportunity, and then the business case is going to start to make itself. So you might say, okay, this is an issue that we have. What can we do with automation? What's out there? What kind of impact does this have on productivity? Again, how do we take control over when we get paid and if we get paid and then how we get paid with that remittance information and get some straight through processing on all fronts? And so there's a lot of opportunity there. So I think it's good, and I love this graphic here. And so those of you that say you don't know whether you have automation in place, this will help you think about having these conversations and being informed. And so we want to look at the order to cash cycle. And so in each area, there's opportunities for improvement. There's places where there's inefficiencies. So again, this might seem like review. I think this is a good slide for me, just when I was in Treasury, just to make sure level set, because I wasn't deeply involved in AR, but I would have loved to have this diagram to just, okay, make sure that I understand. So if I'm going to go over to AR and really want to work with them to own that cash conversion cycle, I need to understand the challenges that they have and what I can do to help them be more productive and help us own our cash conversion cycle. So we have our credit management, right? We want to grant credit. Who do we grant credit to? What are the terms? How do we manage that? How do we look at that counterparty risk? Our order management, our fulfillment, and these are places you might be a little more familiar with in Treasury where we start to have issues. I think really where in Treasury we focus more is on the collections, deductions, and dispute management, and of course the cash applications, but there's so much room on the front end for much better processes and lower processing costs. And so we want to look at this in terms of our customers, right? We don't want to make our customers irritated. So we want to make sure that we have a good customer experience. And this is one place where finance impacts the customer experience. So when I was in Treasury, people would say, this impacts the customer experience. I'd be like, how can we impact the customer experience from finance and Treasury? Well, this is a big way here. So we want to make sure that we have our ducks in order, there's no bottlenecks, and we're very efficient in our collections. Again, why we're having issues, can we look at trends? Do we have visibility into our customers? Do we classify our customers? Can we predict when we're going to get paid? That can help us with our cash forecasting and our working capital optimization. And then where I see a lot of low-hanging fruit here is deduction to dispute management. Again, sometimes it's a matter of just getting into the weeds. We want to automate this, but really helping everyone put codes on there. What's the cause of the dispute? How long does it take? Are there certain people in my department that do this more effectively? How? What's our communication? And then cash application. There's a whole webinar on cash application. And so there's an awful lot of low-hanging fruit there. Again, the worst case scenario is what's happened to me in manufacturing. There's a payment that's in. You hold an order. The cash is there. It's just not applied. Guess I'm going to tell my cash application story. When I was at a manufacturing company, our biggest customer, it took us over a week to do the cash application. And so we want to make this process as smooth as possible. Again, where I see a lot of low-hanging fruit for every company is let's do better at managing the communications with our customers. And then on the collection side, let's be a good partner, right? And so AR done right on our side lowers AP processing costs on their side. So that's really important. So if you want to optimize your AR processing efficiency, you look back and say AR, if your partner has AP and they're doing that correctly and sending you electronic, that's going to lower their processing costs. So there is absolutely a win-win conversation to be had. So let's talk about, you know, evaluating your process. And so again, breaking it down, as everyone knows, I like to keep it simple. And so let's take a look at these three main stages. And this is a way to build that cost up. Okay, what's your invoice delivery? What's that customer payment? And then what's that collections management? And so really, I think what we need to do is we need to do a better job in leveraging metrics. And so first of all, you can't manage what you can't see, right? We got to have visibility into things, but then we need to start looking at what are the metrics that allow us to see how well we're doing in terms of invoice delivery, the timing of payments, our collections management. So we need to have those metrics. So we'll dive into metrics. And so I like to talk a little bit more about metrics than other people. One reason is that people don't really understand, don't really explain metrics. And so for metrics, you want to look at yourself over time. So that's one dimension. Time is one dimension, but then relative to your industry as well. So you don't really want to look at those two in isolation. You want to look at those together. And so some of the, just to pick one of these, a couple of these. So DSO. So you got, first of all, like I mentioned, you want to look at your DSO relative to your terms, right? Does that make sense? Do we have the right terms? If we're having issues with a customer, sometimes there's ways to lower that DSO just by what's in the contract, give them incentives. And so if the money is more valuable to you to get in, instead of borrowing money, you can have those incentives there. You can work with that with your suppliers and work with your customers and do some financing on that side of things. And so it's really important, but you really want to look at that relative to your industry as well. So you can say to me, you know, you're telling me metrics DSO says whatever, 25 days, but in my industry, it just doesn't happen. It's 45 days. And I'll say, okay, well, that might be the case, right? And that might be your upper bound. However, I would say that we want to get better, you know, better than your industry average, because that can be a competitive advantage. But where you stand depends on where you sit, right? And so when you use metrics, again, you look at yourself over time, you want to have this continuous improvement. And then as you're starting to pull levers in automation, tactics, you want to look at the impact on that DSO. So you want to look at that over time. But then if you want to look at the more macro trend, you want to say, okay, we're doing well, we're getting better, but where are we relative to our industry? So that helps us get into this culture of continuous improvement, which I think is tremendously important. On the top side is more of a CFO or treasurer look, we want to look at the cost of our operations and then our bad debt write-offs. And what we'll start to see is that if our benchmarks, any or all these benchmarks are not where we want them to be relative to our industry or relative to even our company going the wrong way, you'll start to see that as you start to dig in, you'll see that technology is often a good way to help us get these moving in the right direction. So let's go ahead and I'm going to launch our next polling question, asking you to share with me which one of the following metrics do you feel is most important to track. So in your company, do you feel it's most important to track deduction days outstanding, day sales outstanding, bad debt write-offs, or cost of AR operations? I didn't want to put all the above. I just was trying to see where folks are at and where folks are really focusing. And I wanted to see if there's some movement around what I've seen for a long time really be the focus. And then once we talk about metrics, we'll talk about where I'm starting to see companies focus more. And so obviously, I think that it's going to, you do well to look at more than one metric, but I just curious, what is that top line metric that folks are still focused on? So I appreciate everyone's consideration in answering all of our polling questions. Once again, if you're interested in receiving CTP credits for today's webinar, you have to answer all of our polling questions. So let me go ahead and leave the polling question up for another few seconds, and then I'll just share with you a few metrics for your information, and then I'll also give you a resource if you want to really see how you might want to benchmark yourself relative to industry peers and what I've found out there. So let's go ahead and close, and let's go ahead and take a quick peek at the results. Thing that stands out to me, I'm not surprised to see DSO at 64%, but I am happy to see that it's not as high as I thought it might be. And so I'm pleasantly surprised to see that folks are measuring the cost of AR operations. And so as you build up that cost, if you really have got that from A to Z with all the people, process, and technology, that's where you'll be able to see where there's opportunities for improvement and bottlenecks. And then you'll start to look at, okay, who's involved in this area? What is it that they're doing that might be driving the time it takes or the hard dollar cost there? And then is there something that we can do to help these people be more efficient? And quite often the answer is going to be technology related. So thank you so much, everyone, for taking the time to answer that polling question and sharing with us today. And so just some statistics that my friends at APQC were willing to send with me. APQC really focuses on process, and so they have some amazing research. So I strongly encourage you, if you're interested in benchmarking your company relative to AR or finance effectiveness or AP, they have a lot of great information there. And so again, just what I want to really try and get out of this slide here is just what I tell folks to focus on is you want to see where you're at, right? So you might not be a top performer, you might not be in the median, you might be somewhere in the middle, but you want to take the perspective of, okay, this is where I'm at, which might be in between here, and this is where I could possibly get to. And so you look at that difference. So let's say, even for the sake of argument, let's say where we could get to $5, right? And we're at $25. That's $20, right? Per receipt, per customer receipt. And then you multiply that by the number of receipts. That's incredible. You look at DSO, right? What's our cost of capital? Here we are, 30 days versus 40 days. How much is that costing your company to not have that money? And are you borrowing money? Is that making you do more FX transactions you don't need to? So there's a lot of ways to look at that value. Number of FTEs. And so I'm not in love with this metric because in some ways what I encourage companies to do is to look at it more in terms of what's the time spent on non-value-add activities. And so what value can I gain, right? Maybe not reducing full-time employees, but if I have folks focusing more on strategic activities, here's what I can work on, my cycle time. So that's really what I want to get my cycle time down, I can reduce costs. And so this one, I don't like to see people say my goal of my AR automation is to reduce headcount. Now that might be what ends up happening, but you should really look at, okay, what's the value? Let's look at all the time that we have that's non-value add activities that we're taking out of the process. Now that Joe has 4 hours a day to not be on the phone, what could Joe be doing to add value, improve our processes, improve our technology, help us to do better with our customer relationships? So that's really maybe a forward-looking attitude, but I strongly encourage that. And then your staff productivity, again, number of receipts processed. And what you'll see here is this is really going to depend on the really almost always the degree of automation that exists. And so again, where you stand depends on where you sit. Your mindset is take a good look in the mirror, assess, right, where are we at on the metrics that matter to my company? What are some metrics of top performers? We might have to tweak that down, but what's the difference, right? What's the value? Let's back of the envelope, dollar cost, cycle time, productivity gain, and you'll start to see the dimensions of that business case come together. How much money am I going to save on cost? Tremendous value. How much time are we going to spend on money that we can have, right? The value of our working capital, cash forecasting accuracy. What's the value of the productivity increases? All the way in accounting, automating accounting, accounts receivable, credit staff, treasury professionals. And so when you start to think about it, what you were doing is you're removing a productivity drag and you're actually fueling growth. And if you tell your CFO you're going to fuel growth from AR down right, I guarantee he's going to pay attention. And so let's go ahead and dive in a little bit deeper. And so again, we're in the weeds a little bit, but I think it's incredibly important, especially since we saw so many of you said you didn't know where you're at with AR automation. And so start to look at that evaluation process either to help you do this or work with your AR team to do this. But stage one is invoice delivery. And so sometimes there's a lot of complication here. And so what you really want to get to is to streamline billing and document archiving. And so really what I'm trying to get to here is electronification on your customer's end does a long way to making things more efficient on your end. And then in terms of customer payment, this is obviously where the rubber meets the road. And so you really want to start to look at if there's trends there, right? What's causing our payments to be delayed? Are they taking discounts that they're not supposed to? Are they doing that on purpose? Is it the end of the month? And so as you start to understand that, you want to engage your sales team as well, and you need to have visibility into that. And so you want to push, you want them to get them paid on time, but you want to understand. So what you don't want to see is customer payment, late payments going on and on and on with no reason. And part of the visibility thing is that the sales guy might have information that the customer payment's going to be late. And so if our sales guy knows that, do we really want to call our customer and send them 10 emails and complain the payment's late when they've already communicated that to us? So we need to be able to have that in our notes. And then we have to say, okay, now this delay in payment, is that okay? Did that get up to the CFO? Is that going to impact our revenue, especially if it's a big customer? And so communication is key. And then on the collection management side, this is tremendously important. Again, we need to understand the tenor of our communications, what works best, email, phone call, frequency of phone call, frequency of phone call, email, but also who is communicating with this customer. Do they have a specific person? Is this our most important customer? Do we want to, we need to engage our sales guy who's in charge of this account. And so let's make sure that we're being cognizant of the impact that we're having on that customer experience. So let me go ahead and launch our next polling question here to also just get a sense, level set a little bit on how you currently generate reports to track your credit and AR performance. Do you use spreadsheets, third-party analytics solution, business intelligence tools, reports generated from your ERP, or do not track? Again, I appreciate everyone's consideration in answering all of our polling questions here today. Those of you interested in receiving CTP credits for today's webinar, you'll have to answer all of our polling questions here today. I also want to remind you that I can take your questions at any time in the questions area of your GoToWebinar control panel. If you have any specific questions about the content or have more in-depth conversation you'd like to have with me, I'm happy to engage with you. You can find me on LinkedIn. Happy to connect and have those conversations with anyone as well. So let's go ahead and take a quick peek at those polling question results, and then we'll start to dig into the business case for AR automation. So again, the first part was let's really help you understand, right, that it really makes sense for us to look at AR automation. But then as we assess ourselves, we're starting, that business case is starting to make itself, and that's why I really took the time to go through the first part of the presentation. Let's go ahead and close. Let's go ahead and take a quick peek at the results. I'm not surprised to see spreadsheets is the highest, but I'm glad to see it's not over 50%. Just a quick note, 27% generated from ERP. ERPs are fantastic for a lot of things. And what I often say is that the AR automation solutions are really, they supercharge what your ERP is doing and what they can tell you in your reporting. and the robustness of your reporting. And so it's not bad to use an ERP system. It's I think it's obviously using Conduction because you're going to be pushing and pulling data. But I think what you'll start to see is if you start to look at these third-party analytics solutions is that you'll be amazed that of the low-hanging fruit that you'll be able to take away. And again, you'll start to see the artificial intelligence come in, and don't be afraid of that word. It, one of the cool things is it's telling you how to more effectively interact with your customers, and that's just amazing and impacting that customer experience. So let's go ahead and really dive in here, and you're more than welcome to request the slides for me. There's a lot of information here, a lot of specific information, which is on purpose. And so I often attend webinars and I don't see anything that I can take away. So I'm very mindful that I want to give you something specific you can print out, you can use, you can have a conversation. And these are really things that are going to help you accomplish your objectives and be more valuable to your company. And so my 10 steps for an effective business case, we'll do a high level, and then we'll start to, and then we'll really dig in specifically more for accounts receivable automation. And so, you know, the first part we talked about this, you need to understand the pain points. And so what are the pain points? And so you can approach this in two ways, really at the high level. How much is it going to cost me if we keep doing business as usual? Sometimes that works depending on your audience, or what's the benefits to us of adopting technology. And I think maybe a combination of both works, but sometimes you have to say, if we keep doing things this way, we're going to have a productivity drag of XYZ. We're going to continue to have a drag on the bottom line of $500,000 a year. Remember, when you remove that processing cost, it's the gift that keeps on giving, right? Year after year, and you're going to keep getting better at that. And so a lot of different areas to look at where we can have some pain points. And again, we can quantify the cost of those. Presentment, collaboration, right, with our customers. We can have misalignment on invoice terms, ineligible discounts, communication barriers due to technology. On the collection side, we need to have visibility. Can't manage what you can't see. We have information asymmetry, not only with our customers, but internally. Isn't it important that if we're all trying to manage the customer relationships and getting paid, that we can all see everything? So we need that information symmetry internally and externally. We have manual tasks and notifications. On the payment side, of course, delinquent payments are costs, and then checks are costly to accept, so we'd rather get those electronic payments without remits detail. And then cash application, again, this speaks to my treasury friends in the audience. Incomplete remittance, inaccurate and incomplete, so that's the whole thing. So as you can see, I'm looking at AR automation, there's a treasure trove of benefits here that you can possibly realize. And then the other thing is that if you already have a solution in place, you should be making sure you're receiving value in all of these areas. So even though you have that solution in place, go back to your AR team and ask them, what are the pain points that we still have, right? And then since we've put this in, are we doing better on collaboration? Are we getting paid more quickly? And so all these things, you should be expecting to get the benefits in all of these areas when you made that investment. And then more generally, you need to define the lay of the land relative to issues that need to be addressed. And so to keep it simple, and this maybe you go across departments, look at it in terms of people, process, and technology. I always encourage people, engage the person that's going to be the person that's going to have the biggest objection to any investment in technology. So maybe that's someone in AR or credit department who's been there a long time. What do you do? You engage them up front. You tell them exactly how this is going to impact what they're doing, how you want to really help them be more valuable. You really appreciate their input. And I've seen this happen before. I was given a business case for some treasury. We are centralizing our cash management. The first question the CFO asks, he walks in, he asks the person from accounts payable who's the most averse to change. He goes, "Hey, Linda, what do you think about this?" And he was waiting to torpedo me. And she goes, "Oh, well, you know, Ernie and I talked about this, and I was very involved in this, and I think this is going to be good for my team." And he about fell out of his chair. And so those are things that you need to be cognizant of. So that's like, and we'll get to that later, but that's called knowing your constituency. You want to offer multiple solutions, and so you don't want to act like you're pushing just one solution and one vendor. Obviously, you want to do that cost-benefit analysis. You have to have defensible assumptions. And some things you might not seem readily apparent, but you do need to look at quantifying those productivity costs. And then you want to include the potential impacts on the bottom line, not only the costs again, but the productivity. You want to make sure you're taking into account hard dollar cost savings, time savings, productivity impacts. Again, the productivity impacts, you go down a level, more time spent on value add activities. And then you want to have that executive summary, delivers the urgency in addressing specific issues, how it's done and what benefits will be realized. In addition to the cost of inaction, the one thing you want to include in the executive summary, you're going to be able to tell what's going to be the biggest objection going up front. So we don't have time for this. We can't do this in air. So you want to address that up front. When we do this, it's going to be the implementation time is going to be XYZ. We're going to see the ROI in XYZ time. And so you need to disarm your people that are going to be your naysayers right out of the gate. Incredibly powerful, especially when you start your meeting. I always say I want to have a stockholders meeting. Who do I need to get on board? Not only who's going to pay for it, but who am I going to impact with my automation? And then I immediately start off with, I'm going to disarm folks right out of the gate. And so, and then put them on my team. So I'm going to turn my naysayers into my evangelists. Again, a big part of that is knowing your constituency. And then you have to present with confidence and passion. If that's not something that you do, you should practice, or maybe you get one of your colleagues to present for you or with you, because you can create a buzz. If you present with confidence and passion, energy, people are going to engage. People respond if you define project roles, responsibility, and you establish accountability for the people that are in your meeting that's going to impact them. Now, John, we're going to need you to do XYZ. And when your team does this, this is really going to drive that ROI. We talked about this. Is that right? Can we do that, right? And then show your CFO or treasurer, whoever, that you really got everybody on board. And then you need to define how all the pieces fit together, right? So everyone has a vested role in the successful project execution. Not only what does execution look like to get it implemented, but what does that look like going forward? So let's continue to report success metrics. We have to define success, measure it, and communicate it. What does that mean? We have to have metrics, benchmarks. We have to establish and maintain accountability. Again, it's the gift that keeps on giving. And so create a metric that says, this is how well we've done since we implemented this AR automation. Then you can start to say, maybe if you implement it in pieces, you can say, okay, since we've done this, right, John's team has done this, and now that's DSO's dropped by XYZ. And so that really gets people engaged, and it keeps people excited, right? We've done all this hard work. Look at the benefits to this. And then this is getting communicated up the channel to the CFO or CSO. So if you're in AR or treasury, you're probably only going to have a few chances to lead a major technology adoption. And so you need to do it right. This can be a career defining moment for you. So let's make sure. And if your treasury and you're not in AR, this you can help your colleagues in AR, right, deliver on this. Again, look at it from the company perspective. No matter where you fit, you want to take control of that cash conversion cycle. And there's a lot of low-hanging fruit there in terms of automating AR to do this. So let's dig down a little bit deeper. And so I love several of these slides are from my webinar partner today, Esker. They've allowed me to borrow these slides. They're incredible. I've never seen this much detail into making the business case. So I strongly encourage you to get the slide deck from me and take this and review it yourself or review it with your team. So you need to get your stakeholders on board. What does that mean? Know your constituency, right? Your executive management, your IT, your AR team, and what do you know? Your sales department. Wouldn't that be nice? It's incredibly powerful if you can get AR and sales to collaborate effectively. And so you got to look at it from the executive management side. I mean, we talked about this before. You got to speak in their language. We're going to generate greater productivity. We're going to maintain current customers and attract new ones. Oh, and by the way, we're going to eliminate wasteful spending, and we're going to improve operational efficiency. Now, if you were to ask me, if you're going to talk to the CFO or CFO, I'm going to start with generate greater productivity and maintain current customers and attract new ones. The second one, you better be ready to tell the story, because if you tell your CFO through accounts receivable done right, you're going to make customer relations better, and you're going to attract new customers. I might give you a weird eyebrow, but I think we've given you enough information to arm you with that. And so the customer relationship from AR starts right from the time that we're pushing that invoice out. And so we're making this process as seamless as possible. Oh, and by the way, AR done right on our side means lower AP processing costs for our customers. And we've communicated with that, and we have visibility, and we have a collaborative relationship in dealing with our customers. We're engaged with sales, and sales is always telling us that we can do better. So we listen to sales. Sales are our internal customer, and this makes our customers happy. You can see your CFOs light up with that. So let's talk about IT language. One of the good things I found about automation solutions, especially cloud-based solutions, excuse me, is that we can actually lower the burden of what IT is doing. So you might be doing a lot of manual things from your ERP system. You might have a lot of reports going back and forth, downloads, pushes and pulls, and we can eliminate a lot of that with the right AR solution. And so, of course, you have to speak the language of IT. So you can look at resources, say we can take care of this in-house. We can make sure that they understand the security and the protocols of our vendors, all those. And then we can also speak to them about how the compatibility and flexibility of a cloud-based solution. And then your solution provider, right, will be able to do that. So they're waiting for your questions, right? So IT is going to ask, what's the cost predictability? You can say them. It's a cost per seat or whatever that might be. We can scale up and down. It's not a fixed cost. Security, we have all of our I don't know what the exact ones are, the ISO 9022 or I guess SOC certifications. We have those. Our folks do this all day, every day. You don't have to focus on that. We can actually mitigate some of that risk. And then compatibility and flexibility to show your IT that we can take control of this. There's no patches, there's no updates. When things are being updated, we get to play in the sandbox. So, and soon as we flip something on the updates, and so you have to be able to answer their questions. So it's more that I see that you're informing IT, you're saying, we're looking at doing this. We want to make sure the impact that this might have on the IT team, and be ready to say, these are the things that we think might be of value, and then engage them, but don't put the burden and onus on them to really own that side of it. Of course, they want to be informed, and you can go back and forth, but if you start to communicate to them how impactful this is going to be to them in terms of their, so then they'll have more time to be more productive. They're going to be pretty engaged with that. And then your AR team. So, and one of the things that we need to do is we have to really create a culture. It's a time for change. And so one of the things that I suggest is always things that I think make common sense, but people don't do it. So I would take my AR team out, all the components of that, right? Collections, Cash App, all the components, invoicing. And so I'd ask them, what are the pain points that you have? So, and let's all get on the same page for those pain points. And then you can even bring up, hey, I was just on a webinar and they said automation can do XYZ. Are you guys familiar with that? Maybe you want to share this webinar recording with them. Maybe you want to give them the slides and kind of have that conversation. I think what you'll start to see is that if you have a conversation with someone and you start with the question, what are the two or three things where you waste the most of your time every day that really aggravate you? And if you tell them, I think if you and I work together, we can eliminate those things. I think you're going to have a pretty receptive audience. And so, so kind of just what happens, right? So how to engage the team. So confirm if you can't confirm invoices, so what's the consequences, right, for your team? And then this helps you relate that right to your C-suite. So you waste time dealing with false invoices. We have lack of customer accountability. We don't have a way to workflow. That's all. Most of these are productivity impacts. What does that cause? Slower collection times, inefficient working capital, optimization, wasting resources on non-value add and productive activities. So this is what you say. You start to go through those three things, right? What's invoicing? What are our challenges, guys? This is what happens. All right, guys. So imagine we could do these things and then they'll be more productive. But how does that translate into what does my CFO care about? These are the things that we care about, right? And so follow up is time consuming and it's an unaccountable process. So what are the consequences for your AR team? So this is helping you make that business case, right? You know what the pain points are. Kind of you can tee them up. Is follow-up time consuming? And do we have enough accountability? And they say, no, I say, well, from my perspective, what I see is these might be some of the challenges that you guys face. There's no real way to prioritize actions. how much time are you wasting doing these things? How much time are you spending on non-value-add activities? And then you start to look at, folks, your tedious activities, day-to-day tasks, isn't that frustrating? And then if you want to kind of move that up to the C-suite language, right? Lower staff productivity. And so again, I think these slides are incredibly powerful. I wish I would have had these when I was in Treasury, but it's really walking you through, right? There's no self-service options for customers. We talked about this, but this is a better way to look at it, right? You're causing inherent barriers to effective collaboration. You can't have when you have asymmetry of information, it just causes frustrations, and there's no way to track how quickly your customer questions are being addressed. And so you want to understand the nature of questions and issues. You want to understand how you're resolving them now. And then we want to see how do we mitigate those issues from even happening. And if they're going to happen, really, really important, how do we make sure they don't happen again? And that's where I see an awful lot of low-hanging fruit. So when I see customers invest in the time categorizing what the issues are, but really having the visibility into understanding what those root causes are. And sometimes we do have to engage our sales team, right? And maybe it's the terms. And so there's always a way forward, right? I think there's almost always a win-win solution in there somewhere. And then, consequences, right? For the asymmetry of information, we're going to make our customers unhappy. We're going to make our staff unhappy. And then we're going to have late payments. And so there's going to be cost on that side of it. And then just looking at the taking it to the bottom line, the advantages, right, for the AR team, you're processing invoices, you have greater oversight, you have less time spent handling paper documents, high rates where you get folks in your customer portal, you're going to lower that asymmetry of information, you have greater job satisfaction, and then you have more time for personal development, working on relationships based on facts, not based on I'm seeing this, you're seeing that. Allows them to get the ability to track process improvements and customize workflow, and then it allows you to be able to manage growth effectively. And so identify, and so you can get more input, right, from your team. They'll start to see that you're not pushing work on them. You want them to communicate with you ideas that we can help you with to be more productive. And then as they have more time to be analytical, you'll be amazed at all these benefits that you'll get from your AR team, which will result in reduced DSO, improved communication, and happier staff members. And I think that's something that is tremendously powerful in greater professional development, and then lower staff turnover. And I think another piece of this, which doesn't get talked enough about, is that you could have some folks that are going to be scared that they're going to lose their jobs from AR automation and artificial intelligence. My answer to that is it's a tremendously valuable time to be in the industry because you're hitting at a time where there's time to recreate your value proposition. And so what can you do with more time? How can you offer more value? How can you improve those customer relationships? How can you help procurement be more effective? And so I think it's an incredibly exciting time if it's taken the right way. So having that time back, being more valuable, not working out of your inbox can be an incredibly powerful incentive for someone to really get more in their analytical toolbox and then get more of a handle on technology. So you can actually drive technology adoption across the company from accounts receivable. So what about your sales department? Again, when you talk to your sales department, again, of course, this speaks to your sales guys. What do you guys want to do? Say, this is what we want to work with you guys. With AR automation, this is what we're going to do. We're going to have happier customers, efficiency, greater insight. What's going to happen? We're going to get paid more quickly. You're going to get commission checks more quickly, and then we're going to have fewer ways in order to fewer calls to your customers, which means they're going to be happy with you. And so if you look at the stages of strategic value, so this is a great way to really look at that business case as well. And so we talked about the three that we'll talk about a few stages here. Operational efficiency, what does that look like? In a really good high level, fewer manual tasks, right? Where are you at now? Where can you get to? What's the time saving? Simplified IT environment, right? Let's get our IT folks on board. System consolidation, fewer resources to govern system, right? continuous software upgrades that don't involve your IT department. These hard dollar cost savings on suppliers and equipment, document processing, overtime, right? Headcount, greater visibility and oversight. I think that's where I really like to focus. Instant access to any order, invoice, reviews, customizable KPIs, complete audit trail recorded. And so you can't manage what you can't see. Again, once you get that visibility into all your customer interactions and build up the cost to process that invoice, you'll start to see that. And that's on the operational side. And then this is the improved experience for your staff and your customers. And so for your staff, you're taking away those non-value-add activities. You have happier customers, which means they're more open to collaboration. And if you reach out and say, hey, John, I've never really seen this happen before. Is there something that happened this month where you had to pay late? Is that something we're going to see going forward? I'm just checking in because I'm really amazed how you guys are paying on time every time. And so all these things that you're going to go from where you're at to where you could be, again, things that make customers happier is their self-service, faster dispute create and resolution. Again, let's look at that business case value, the soft dollar savings. We need to look at all the dimensions of that business case, right? Increased productivity, higher staff retention, and a lower customer and employee churn. You start to look at that customer satisfaction. And then my favorite on this slide, more collaboration. Better company to customer communication, but also harmonization across departments and subsidiaries. So I think this is incredibly important and a point not to be missed. Technology really allows us to manage AR in a holistic manner and not in a silo. And so it's not so much that corporate is going to push down everything to the subsidiaries. It's more about harmonization. Let's take those best practices and have corporate take those and communicate those and get us all on the same page. And then the more collaboration we have, the more communication we have, the more visibility we have means more accountability on the individual and team level. And all these things lead to, you know, this business buzzword, which is business agility, but it's incredibly important. I don't know if you can future-proof growth, but you can absolutely support growth. The worst thing that can happen is that your systems can inhibit growth. In my older days, there were things we couldn't do, which inhibited our growth. We couldn't invoice customers a certain way. That just makes no sense. If your business technology is driving your business practices, that's when you really need to know that you need to invest in technology. And then really what this visibility gives us and the fact that folks have more time to spend on strategic activities. Again, this goes across AR. This goes across the treasury. This goes across, you know, people, the credit manager, director of credit, really spending time on things that are really non-value-add activities. This means expansion into new markets, new sales, new business. And then at the end of the day, speaks to everyone, right? You have higher profits. Yes, how do we get there? I think we've shown that. So you look at, right, where are you at in terms of your pain points, where can you get to? And then let's see, you know, how did we get to higher profits? Greater efficiency, right? Lower costs, more productive staff, happier customers, open the door to a new customer, which adds up, right? The world's a perfect place. No, but I'm not going to be able to answer all of your questions or really spread your company, but I hope I'm giving you the motivation to really take a look at AR automation. If you're looking or haven't looked, or if you already have a solution, let's make sure that you're getting the most out of it. And then also on the business case side, I think there's a lot of projects beyond AR that really get lost because of the methodology of the business case. And so I really love this slide here, and this is a slide I would certainly print out. And so this gives you just like a good visual way to look at how this what you're looking for with the right technology in terms of AR automation, just an example, and also helps you kind of look at owning that cash conversion cycle. And so, you know, we have the O2C and P2P, and so I think this is a really good way for my treasury folks and my CFOs. And then these are things that you want to look for when a partner You want to look at a multi-tenant platform. That means cloud-based. You want to have your HIPAA compliance. These are the certifications. You want to look at 24/7 availability, and then you want to look at possibly paying as you go. And then you want to look at multiple data centers. So I think this just shows what is offered from in terms of one leading company. This helps you see what's possible, and this is possible for companies of all sizes. And so we really focused on this side of it. But at the end of the day, what you want to do is you want to control, you want to look at that cash conversion cycle. So let's give you the really way. So this is really where you get someone's attention. 10 ways AR done right impacts the bottom line. So this is a couple slides or things that I've come together. I've been talking about AR automation a lot more the last 3 or 4 years. And so I've put together these 10 things, and these 10 things are really can be components of that value proposition for that business case. So AR automation removes manual processing and associated errors. That lowers your processing costs. AR automation mitigates time wasted on internally communicating, this is important, within and across departments about AR-related issues, lowering your processing costs. AR automation mitigates bad debt write-offs. We understand our customers. We do a better job on the front end of managing those credit limits. Helps us mitigate disputes with customers more effectively by removing asymmetry of information and facilitating effective communication. And so a lot of times what I found, the disputes are just based on you're not looking at the same information, or there one party will claim, well, I can't see that. Well, yes, you can. Here, let's do this right now. Let's do a go-to meeting. This is what we're looking at. And so also improves the productivity of all those involved in processing receivables. Again, more focus on value-add activities. AR automation improves the customer experience, customer relationships, lowers AP processing costs for customers, right, which positively impacts customer relationships, can eliminate the need for lockbox fees on the cash application side, improves the forecasting of cash. This leads to improved working capital management. And then AR automation mitigates the use of internal IT resources. And so that's pretty powerful. So I think at the end of the day, just a few closing thoughts, and I hope this has become clear from our time together today. AR automation warrants consideration for companies of all sizes. AR automation done right lowers processing costs, facilitates effective performance reporting, and impacts productivity within and beyond AR. It can positively impact customer relationships, and it helps companies get paid and get paid on their terms. And so I think when you really start to take the time to look at, take that good look in the mirror where you're at, and then take a look at what's out there, the metrics, the case studies by industry. And so there's so much a wealth of information out there in order to help you make this business case and do back of the envelope calculations just to say, wow, this is really deserves my attention. A few resources that I'd like to share. Esker, our webinar partner today, has some really good thought leadership resources hyperlinked there. Here's the order to cash automation, the 4 stages of strategic benefits, some of that content I shared today, and then AR on your terms. And so they have some tremendous resources if you want more information on that. So as I wrap things up, I'm going to go ahead and launch our final polling question for you today. And as we have that final polling question up, I would like to take the time to let everybody know, if you're not aware already, Treasury Webinars is going to be delivering the first ever Treasury and Finance Virtual Conference on April 21st to 23rd, 2020. If you've ever been to an in-person conference, we are going to replicate that experience. And I have experienced virtual conferences myself, and it is nothing short of amazing. So I strongly encourage you to let me know if you have an interest. You don't have to be there the entire 3 days. You can just register and come and see what the virtual experience is all about. It's really amazing to see what we can do in that virtual world together. So let me go ahead, leave that polling question up for just another few seconds. I want to make sure that all of you that are interested in receiving CTP credits have the opportunity to answer that polling question. So let me go ahead, I'll give you guys a few more seconds here. Okay, thank you so much. And finally, I would once again like to thank our webinar partner today, Esker. We sincerely appreciate their commitment to thought leadership. And I also want to thank you, the audience, so much for your valuable time. I appreciate each and every one of you. Make the rest of your day great, everyone.